Chapter 3, a parable. Then the venerable Sariputra, pleased, glad, charmed, cheerful, thrilling with delight and joy, stretched his joined hands towards the Lord, and looking up to the Lord with a steady gaze, addressed him in this strain. I am astonished, amazed, O Lord, I am in ecstasy to hear such a call from the Lord. For when, before I had heard of this law from the Lord, I saw other bodhisattvas, and heard that the bodhisattvas would in future get the name of Buddhas, I felt extremely sorry, extremely vexed, to be deprived from so grand a sight as the Tathagata knowledge. And whenever, O Lord, for my daily recreation I was visiting the caves of rocks or mountains, wood thickets, lovely gardens, rivers, and roots of trees, I always was occupied with the same and ever recurring thought, whereas the entrance into the fixed points of the law is nominally equal, we have been dismissed by the Lord with the inferior vehicle. Instantly, however, O Lord, I felt that it was our own fault, not the Lord's, for had we regarded the Lord at the time of his giving the all-surpassing demonstration of the law, that is, the exposition of supreme perfect enlightenment, then, O Lord, we should have become adepts in those laws. But because, without understanding the mystery of the Lord, we, at the moment of the bodhisattvas, not being assembled, heard only in a hurry, caught, meditated, minded, took to heart the first lessons pronounced on the law, therefore, O Lord, I used to pass day and night in self-reproach. But today, O Lord, I have reached complete extinction. Today, O Lord, I have become calm. Today, O Lord, I am wholly come to rest. Today, O Lord, I have reached arhatship. Today, O Lord, I am the Lord's eldest son, born from his law, sprung into existence by the law, made by the law, inheriting from the law, accomplished by the law. My burning has left me, O Lord, now that I have heard this wonderful law, which I had not learned before, announced by the voice from the mouth of the Lord. And on that occasion, the venerable Sariputra addressed the Lord in the following stanzas. 1. I am astonished, great leader. I am charmed to hear this voice. I feel no doubt anymore. Now am I fully ripe for the superior vehicle. 2. Wonderful is the voice of the Sugatas. It dispels the doubt and pain of living beings. My pain also is all gone now that I, freed from imperfections, have heard that voice or call. 3. When I was taking my daily recreation, or was walking in woody thickets, when betaking myself to the roots of trees or to mountain caves, I indulged in no other thought but this: oh, how am I deluded by vain thoughts! Whereas the faultless laws are nominally equal, shall I in future not preach the superior law in the world? 5. The 32 characteristic signs have failed me, and the gold color of the skin has vanished. All the 10 powers and emancipations have likewise been lost. Oh, how have I gone astray at the equal laws! The secondary signs also of the great seers, the 80 excellent specific signs, and the 18 uncommon properties have failed me. Oh, how am I deluded! And when I had perceived thee, so benign and merciful to the world, and was lonely, walking to take my daily recreation, I thought, I am excluded from that inconceivable, unbounded knowledge. Days and nights, O Lord, I passed always thinking of the same subject. I would ask the Lord whether I had lost my rank or not. In such reflections, O chief of Ginas, I constantly passed my days and nights, and on seeing many other bodhisattvas praised by the leader of the world. 10. And on hearing this Buddha law, I thought, to be sure, this is expounded mysteriously. It is an inscrutable, subtle, and faultless science, which is announced by the Ginas on the terrace of enlightenment. Formerly, I was attached to heretical theories, being a wandering monk and in high honor, or of the same opinions with the heretics. Afterwards was the Lord, regarding my disposition, taught me nirvana, to detach me from perverted views. After having completely freed myself from all heretical views and reached the laws of void, I conceive that I have become extinct, yet this is not deemed to be extinction. But when one becomes Buddha, a superior being honored by men, gods, goblins, titans, and adorned with the 32 characteristic signs, then one will be completely extinct. All those former cares have now been dispelled since I have heard the voice. Now am I extinct, as thou announcest my destination to nirvana before the world, including the gods. When I first heard the voice of the Lord, I had a great terror lest it might be Mara, the evil one, who on this occasion had adopted the disguise of Buddha. But when the unsurpassed Buddha wisdom had been displayed in and established with arguments, reasons, and illustrations by myriads of Kotis, then I lost all doubt about the law I heard. And when thou hadst mentioned to me the thousands of Kotis of Buddhas, the past Ginas, who have come to final rest, and how they preach this law by firmly establishing it through skillfulness, how the many future Buddhas and those who are now existing as knowers of the real truth shall expound or are expounding this law by hundreds of able devices. And when thou wert mentioning thine own course after leaving home, how the idea of the wheel of the law presented itself to thy mind, and how thou decidest upon preaching the law. 20. Then I was convinced, this is not Mara. It is the Lord of the world who has shown the true course. No Maras can here abide. So then my mind for a moment was overcome with perplexity. But when the sweet, deep, and lovely voice of Buddha gladdened me, all doubts were scattered, my perplexity vanished, and I stood firm in knowledge. I shall become a Tathagata, undoubtedly worshipped in the world, including the gods. I shall manifest Buddha wisdom, mysteriously rousing many bodhisattvas. After the speech of the Venerable Sariputra, the Lord said to him, I declare to thee, Sariputra, I announce to thee in presence of this world, including the gods, Maras, and Brahmas, in presence of this people, including ascetics and Brahmins, that thou, Sariputra, hast been by me made ripe for supreme perfect enlightenment, in presence of 20,000 myriads of Kotis of Buddhas, and that thou, Sariputra, hast for a long time followed my commandments. Thou, Sariputra, art, by the counsel of the Bodhisattva, by the decree of the Bodhisattva, reborn here under my rule. Owing to the mighty will of the Bodhisattva, thou, Sariputra, hast no recollection of thy former vow to observe the religious course of the counsel of the Bodhisattva, the decree of the Bodhisattva. Thou thinkest that thou hast reached final rest. I, wishing to revive and renew in thee the knowledge of thy former vow to observe the religious course, will reveal to the disciples the Dharma Paryaya, called the Lotus of the True Law, this Sutranta. Again, Sariputra, at a future period, after innumerable, inconceivable, immeasurable aeons, when thou shalt have learnt the true law of 100,000 myriads of Kotis of Tathagatas, showed devotion in various ways and achieved the present Bodhisattva course, that thou shalt become in the world a Tathagata named Padma Prabha, endowed with science and conduct, a Sugata, a knower of the world, an unsurpassed tamer of men, a master of gods and men, a Lord Buddha. At that time then, Sariputra, the Buddha field of that Lord, the Tathagata Padma Prabha, to be called Varaga, will be level, pleasant, delightful, extremely beautiful to see, pure, prosperous, rich, quiet, abounding with food, replete with many races of men. It will consist of lapis lazuli and contain a checkerboard of 8 compartments distinguished by gold threads, each compartment having its jewel tree always and perpetually filled with blossoms and fruits of 7 precious substances. Now that Tathagata Padma Prabha Sariputra will preach the law by the instrumentality of 3 vehicles. Further, Sariputra, that Tathagata will not appear at the decay of the aeon, but preach the law by virtue of a vow. That aeon, Sariputra, will be named Maharatna Pratimandita, i.e. ornamented with magnificent jewels. Knowest thou, Sariputra, why that aeon is named Maharatna Pratimandita? The bodhisattvas of a Buddha field, Sariputra, are called ratnas, jewels. And at that time, there will be many bodhisattvas in that sphere called viraga, innumerable, incalculable, beyond computation, abstraction made from their being computed by the Tathagatas. On that account is that aeon called Maharatna Pratimandita. Now to proceed, Sariputra, at that period, the bodhisattvas of that field will in walking step on jewel lotuses. And these bodhisattvas will not be plying their work for the first time, they having accumulated roots of goodness and observed the course of duty under many 100,000 Buddhas. They are praised by the Tathagatas for their zealous application to Buddha knowledge, are perfectioned in the rites preparatory to transcendent knowledge, accomplished in the direction of all true laws, mild, thoughtful. Generally, Sariputra, will that Buddha region teem with such bodhisattvas? As to the lifetime, Sariputra, of that Tathagata, Padma Prabha, it will last 12 intermediate kalpas if we leave out of account the time of his being a young prince. And the lifetime of the creatures then living will measure 8 intermediate kalpas. At the expiration of 12 intermediate kalpas, Sariputra, the Tathagata Padma Prabha, after announcing the future destiny of the bodhisattva called Driti Paripurna to superior perfect enlightenment, is to enter complete nirvana. This bodhisattva, Mahasattva, Driti Paripurna, O monks, shall immediately after me come to supreme perfect enlightenment. He shall become in the world a Tathagata named Padma Vrisha Bhavikramin, an arhat endowed with science and conduct. Now the Tathagata Padma Vrisha Bhavikramin, Sariputra, will have a Buddha field of quite the same description. The true law, Sariputra, of that Tathagata Padma Vrisha Bhavikramin will, after his extinction, last 32 intermediate kalpas, and the counterfeit of his true law will last as many intermediate kalpas. And on that occasion, the Lord uttered the following stanzas. 23. Thou also, son of Sari, shalt in future be a Gina, a Tathagata named Padma Prabha, of unlimited sight. Thou shalt educate thousands of kotis of living beings. After paying honor to many kotis of Buddhas, making strenuous efforts in the course of duty, and after having produced in thyself the 10 powers, thou shalt reach supreme perfect enlightenment. Within a period inconceivable and immense, there shall be an aeon rich in jewels, or the aeon jewel-rich, in a sphere named Viraga, the pure field of the highest of men. And its ground will consist of lapis lazuli, and be set off with gold threads. It will have hundreds of jewel trees, very beautiful, and covered with blossoms and fruits. Bodhisattvas of good memory, able in showing the course of duty, which they have been taught under hundreds of Buddhas, will come to be born in that field. And the aforementioned Gina, then in his last bodily existence, shall, after passing the state of Prince Royal, renounce sensual pleasures, leave home to become a wandering ascetic, and therefore after reach the supreme and the highest enlightenment. The lifetime of that jnana will be precisely 12 intermediate kalpas, and the life of men will then last 8 intermediate kalpas. 30. After the extinction of the Tathagata, the true law will continue 32 aeons in full, for the benefit of the world, including the gods. When the true law shall have come to an end, its counterfeit will stand for 32 intermediate kalpas. The dispersed relics of the Holy One will always be honored by men and gods. Such will be the fate of that Lord. Rejoice, O son of Sari, for it is thou who shalt be that most excellent of men, so unsurpassed. The four classes of the audience, monks, nuns, lay devotees, male and female, gods, nagas, goblins, gandharvas, demons, garudas, kinaras, great serpents, men and beings not human, on hearing the announcement of the venerable Sariputra's destiny to supreme perfect enlightenment, were so pleased, glad, charmed, thrilling with delight and joy that they covered the Lord severally with their own robes, while Indra, the chief of gods, Brahma, Sahampati, besides hundred thousands of kotis of other divine beings, covered him with heavenly garments and bestrewed him with flowers of heaven, mandravas and great mandaravas. High aloft, they whirled celestial clothes and struck hundred thousands of celestial musical instruments and cymbals high in the sky. And after pouring a great rain of flowers, they uttered these words: the wheel of the law has been put in motion by the Lord, the first time at Benares, at Rishipatana in the deer park. Today has the Lord again put in motion the supreme wheel of the law. And on that occasion, those divine beings uttered the following stanzas. The wheel of the law was put in motion by thee, O thou that art unrivaled in the world at Benares. O great hero, that wheel which is the rotation of the great rise and decay of all aggregates. There it was put in motion for the first time, now a second time it is turned here, O Lord. Today, O Master, thou hast preached this law which is hard to be received with faith. Many laws have we heard near the Lord of the world, but never before do we hear a law like this. We receive with gratitude, O great hero, the mysterious speech of the great sages, such as this prediction regarding the self-possessed Arya Sariputra. May we also become such incomparable Buddhas in the world, who by mysterious speech announce supreme Buddha enlightenment. May we also, by the good we have done in this world and in the next, and by our having propitiated the Buddha, be allowed to make a vow for Buddhaship. Thereupon the venerable Sariputra thus spoke to the Lord: my doubt is gone, O Lord. My uncertainty is at an end on hearing from the mouth of the Lord my destiny to supreme enlightenment. But these 1,200 self-controlled disciples, O Lord, who have been placed by thee on the stage of Saikshas, have been thus admonished and instructed. My preaching of the law, O monks, comes to this: that deliverance from birth, decrepitude, disease, and death is inseparably connected with nirvana. And these 2,000 monks, O Lord, thy disciples, both those who are still under training and adepts, who all of them are free from false views about the soul, false views about existence, false views about cessation of existence, free in short from all false views, who are fancying themselves to have reached the stage of nirvana. These have fallen into uncertainty by hearing from the mouth of the Lord this law which they had not heard before. Therefore, O Lord, please speak to these monks to dispel their uneasiness, so that the four classes of the audience, O Lord, may be relieved from their doubt and perplexity. On this speech of the venerable Sariputra, the Lord said to him the following: Have I not told thee before, Sariputra, that the Tathagata preaches the law by able devices, varying directions and indications, fundamental ideas, interpretations with due regard to the different dispositions and inclinations of creatures whose temperaments are so various? All his preachings of the law have no other end but supreme and perfect enlightenment, for which he is arousing beings to the Bodhisattva course. But Sariputra, to elucidate this matter more at large, I will tell thee a parable, for men of good understanding will generally readily enough catch the meaning of what is taught under the shape of a parable. Let us suppose the following case, Sariputra. In a certain village, town, borough, province, kingdom, or capital, there was a certain housekeeper, old, aged, decrepit, very advanced in years, rich, wealthy, opulent. He had a great house, high, spacious, built a long time ago and old, inhabited by some 200, 300, 400, or 500 living beings. The house had but one door and a thatch. Its terraces were tottering, the bases of its pillars rotten, the coverings and plaster of the walls loose on a sudden. The whole house was from every side put in conflagration by a mass of fire. Let us suppose that the man had many little boys, say 5 or 10 or even 20, and that he himself had come out of the house. Now, Sariputra, that man, on seeing the house from every side wrapped in a blaze by a great mass of fire, got afraid, frightened, anxious in his mind, and made the following reflection. I myself am able to come out from the burning house through the door quickly and safely, without being touched or scorched by that great mass of fire. But my children, those young boys, are staying in the burning house, playing, amusing, and diverting themselves with all sorts of sports. They do not perceive, nor know, nor understand, nor mind that the house is on fire, and do not get afraid. Though scorched by that great mass of fire and affected with such a mass of pain, they do not mind the pain, nor do they conceive the idea of escaping. The man, Sariputra, is strong, has powerful arms, and so he makes this reflection. I am strong and have powerful arms. Why, let me gather all my little boys and take them to my breast to effect their escape from the house. A second reflection then presented itself to his mind. This house has but one opening. The door is shut, and those boys, fickle, unsteady, and childlike as they are, will, it is to be feared, run hither and thither, and come to grief and disaster in this mass of fire. Therefore, I will warn them. So resolved, he calls the boys. Come, my children, the house is burning with a mass of fire. Come, lest ye be burnt in that mass of fire, and come to grief and disaster. But the ignorant boys do not heed the words of him who is their well-wisher. They are not afraid, not alarmed, and feel no misgiving. They do not care, nor fly, nor even know, nor understand the purport of the word burning. On the contrary, they run hither and thither, walk about, and repeatedly look at their father, all because they are so ignorant. Then the man is going to reflect thus. The house is burning, is blazing by a mass of fire. It is to be feared that myself, as well as my children, will come to grief and disaster. Let me therefore by some skillful means get the boys out of the house. The man knows the disposition of the boys and has a clear perception of their inclinations. Now these boys happen to have many and manifold toys to play with, pretty, nice, pleasant, dear, amusing, and precious. The man, knowing the disposition of the boys, says to them, my children, your toys, which are so pretty, precious, and admirable, which you are so loth to miss, which are so various and multifarious, such as bullock carts, goat carts, deer carts, which are so pretty, nice, dear, and precious to you, have all been put by me outside the house door for you to play with. Come, run out, leave the house to each of you. I shall give what he wants. Come soon, come out for the sake of these toys. And the boys, on hearing the names mentioned of such playthings as they like and desire, so agreeable to their taste, so pretty, dear, and delightful, quickly rush out from the burning house with eager effort and great alacrity, one having no time to wait for the other and pushing each other on with the cry of "Who shall ride first?" the very first. The man, seeing that his children have safely and happily escaped, and knowing that they are free from danger, goes and sits down in the open air on the square of the village, his heart filled with joy and delight, released from trouble and hindrance, quite at ease. The boys go up to the place where their father is sitting and say, "Father, give us those toys to play with, those bullock carts, goat carts, and deer carts." Then Sariputra, the man, gives to his sons, who run swift as the wind, bullock carts only, made of 7 precious substances, provided with benches, hung with a multitude of small bells, lofty, adorned with rare and wonderful jewels, embellished with jewel wreaths, decorated with garlands of flowers, carpeted with cotton mattresses and woolen coverlets, covered with white cloth and silk, having on both sides rosy cushions, yoked with white, very fair and fleet bullocks, led by a multitude of men. To each of his children he gives several bullock carts of one appearance and one kind, provided with flags and swift as the wind. That man does so, Sariputra, because, being rich, wealthy, and in possession of many treasures and granaries, he rightly thinks, "Why should I give these boys inferior carts, all these boys being my own children, dear and precious? I have got such great vehicles, and ought to treat all the boys equally and without partiality. As I own many treasures and granaries, I could give such great vehicles to all beings, how much more than to my own children?" Meanwhile, the boys are mounting the vehicles with feelings of astonishment and wonder. "Now, Sariputra, what is thy opinion? Has that man made himself guilty of a falsehood by first holding out to his children the prospect of 3 vehicles and afterwards giving to each of them the greatest vehicles only, the most magnificent vehicles?" Sariputra answered, "By no means, Lord, by no means, Sugata. That is not sufficient, O Lord, to qualify the man as a speaker of falsehood, since it only was a skillful device to persuade his children to go out of the burning house and save their lives. Nay, besides recovering their very body, O Lord, they have received all those toys. If that man, O Lord, had given no single cart, even then he would not have been a speaker of falsehood, for he had previously been meditating on saving the little boys from a great mass of pain by some able device. Even in this case, O Lord, the man would not have been guilty of falsehood, and far less now that he, considering his having plenty of treasures and prompted by no other motive but the love of his children, gives to all, to coax them, vehicles of one kind, and those the greatest vehicles. That man, O Lord, is not guilty of falsehood." The venerable Sariputra, having thus spoken, the Lord said to him, "Very, very well. Very well, Sariputra, quite so. It is even as thou sayest. So too, Sariputra, the Tathagata is free from all dangers, wholly exempt from all misfortune, despondency, calamity, pain, grief, the thick enveloping dark mists of ignorance. He, the Tathagata, endowed with Buddha knowledge, forces, absence of hesitation, uncommon properties, and mighty by magical power, is the father of the world, who has reached the highest perfection in the knowledge of skillful means, who is most merciful, long-suffering, benevolent, compassionate. He appears in this triple world, which is like a house, the roof and shelter whereof are decayed, burning by a mass of misery, in order to deliver from affection, hatred, and delusion the being subject to birth, old age, disease, death, grief, wailing, pain, melancholy, despondency, the dark enveloping mists of ignorance, in order to rouse him to supreme and perfect enlightenment. Once born, he sees how the creatures are burnt, tormented, vexed, distressed by birth, old age, disease, death, grief, wailing, pain, melancholy, despondency. How, for the sake of enjoyments and prompted by sensual desires, they severally suffer various pains, in consequence, both of what in this world they are seeking, and what they have acquired, they will in a future state suffer various pains in hell, in the brute creation, in the realm of Yama, suffer such pains as poverty in the world of gods or men, union with hateful persons or things, and separation from the beloved ones. And whilst incessantly whirling in that mass of evils, they are sporting, playing, diverting themselves. They do not fear nor dread, nor are they seized with terror. They do not know nor mind. They are not startled, do not try to escape, but are enjoying themselves in that triple world, which is like unto a burning house, and run hither and thither. Though overwhelmed by that mass of evil, they do not conceive the idea that they must be aware of it. Under such circumstances, Sariputra, the Tathagata reflects thus, verily, I am the father of these beings. I must save them from this mass of evil and bestow on them the immense inconceivable bliss of Buddha knowledge, wherewith they shall sport, play, and divert themselves, wherein they shall find their rest. Then Sariputra, the Tathagata, reflects thus, if in the conviction of my possessing the power of knowledge and magical faculties, I manifest to these beings the knowledge, forces, and absence of hesitation of the Tathagata, without availing myself of some device, these beings will not escape, for they are attached to the pleasures of the five senses, to worldly pleasures. They will not be freed from birth, old age, disease, death, grief, wailing, pain, melancholy, despondency, by which they are burnt, tormented, vexed, distressed, unless they are forced to leave the triple world, which is like a house, the shelter and roof whereof is in a blaze. How are they to get acquainted with Buddha knowledge? Now, Sariputra, even as that man with powerful arms, without using the strength of his arms, attracts his children out of the burning house by an able device, and afterwards gives them magnificent great carts, so Sariputra, the Tathagata, the Arhat, possessed of knowledge and freedom from all hesitation, without using them in order to attract the creatures out of the triple world, which is like a burning house with decayed roof and shelter, shows by his knowledge of able devices three vehicles: the vehicle of the disciples, the vehicle of the Pratyeka Buddhas, and the vehicle of the Bodhisattvas. By means of these three vehicles, he attracts the creatures and speaks to them thus: do not delight in this triple world, which is like a burning house, in these miserable forms, sounds, odors, flavors, and contacts. For in delighting in this triple world, ye are burnt, heated, inflamed with the thirst inseparable from the pleasures of the five senses. Fly from this triple world, betake yourselves to the three vehicles: the vehicle of the disciples, the vehicle of the Pratyeka Buddhas, the vehicle of the Bodhisattvas. I give you my pledge for it that I shall give you these three vehicles, make an effort to run out of this triple world, and to attract them, I say. These vehicles are grand, praised by the Aryas, and provided with most pleasant things. With such you are to sport, play, and divert yourselves in a noble manner. Ye will feel the great delight of the faculties, powers, constituents of Bodhi, meditations, the 8 degrees of emancipation, self-concentration, and the results of self-concentration, and ye will become greatly happy and cheerful. Now, Sariputra, the beings who have become wise have faith in the Tathagata, the father of the world, and consequently apply themselves to his commandments. Amongst them, there are some who, wishing to follow the dictate of an authoritative voice, apply themselves to the commandment of the Tathagata for acquiring the knowledge of the four great truths for the sake of their own complete nirvana. These one may say to be those who, coveting the vehicle of the disciples, fly from the triple world, just as some of the boys will fly from that burning house, prompted by a desire of getting a cart yoked with deer. Other beings, desirous of the science without a master, of self-restraint and tranquility, apply themselves to the commandment of the Tathagata to learn to understand causes and effects for the sake of their own complete nirvana. These one may say to be those who, coveting the vehicle of the Pratyeka Buddhas, fly from the triple world, just as some of the boys fly from the burning house prompted by the desire of getting a cart yoked with goats. Others again desirous of the knowledge of the all-knowing, the knowledge of Buddha, the knowledge of the self-born one, the science without a master, apply themselves to the commandment of the Tathagata to learn, to understand the knowledge, powers, and freedom from hesitation of the Tathagata. For the sake of the common well and happiness, out of compassion to the world, for the benefit, well, and happiness of the world at large, both gods and men, for the sake of the complete nirvana of all beings. These one may say to be those who, coveting the great vehicle, fly from the triple world. Therefore, they are called bodhisattvas, mahasattvas. They may be likened to those among the boys who have fled from the burning house, prompted by the desire of getting a cart yoked with bullocks. In the same manner, Sariputra, as that man, on seeing his children escaped from the burning house and knowing them safely and happily rescued and out of danger in the consciousness of his great wealth, gives the boys one single grand cart, so too Sariputra, the Tathagata, the Arhat, on seeing many kotis of beings recovered from the triple world, released from sorrow, fear, terror, and calamity, having escaped owing to the command of the Tathagata, delivered from all fears, calamities, and difficulties, and having reached the bliss of nirvana, so too, Sariputra, the Tathagata, the Arhat, considering that he possesses great wealth of knowledge, power, and absence of hesitation, and that all beings are his children, leads them by no other vehicle but the Buddha vehicle to full development. But he does not teach a particular nirvana for each being. He causes all beings to reach complete nirvana by means of the complete nirvana of the Tathagata. And those beings, Sariputra, who are delivered from the triple world, to them, the Tathagata gives as toys to amuse themselves with the lofty pleasures of the Aryas, the pleasures of meditation, emancipation, self-concentration, and its results, all of the same kind, even as that man, Sariputra, cannot be said to have told a falsehood for having held out to those boys the prospect of three great vehicles and given to them all but one great vehicle, a magnificent vehicle made of seven precious substances, decorated with all sorts of ornaments, a vehicle of one kind, the most egregious of all. So too Sariputra, the Tathagata, the Arhat, tells no falsehood when, by an able device, he first holds forth three vehicles and afterwards leads all to complete nirvana by the one great vehicle. For the Tathagata, Sariputra, who is rich in treasures and storehouses of abundant knowledge, powers, and absence of hesitation, is able to teach all beings the law which is connected with the knowledge of the all-knowing. In this way, Sariputra, one has to understand how the Tathagata, by an able device and direction, shows but one vehicle, the great vehicle. And on that occasion, the Lord uttered the following stanzas, 39. A man has an old house, large but very infirm. Its terraces are decaying and the columns rotten at their bases. 40. The windows and balconies are partly ruined, the wall as well as its coverings and plaster decaying. The copping shows rents from age, the thatch is everywhere pierced with holes. 41. It is inhabited by no less than 500 beings, containing many cells and closets, filled with excrements and disgusting. 42. Its roof rafters are wholly ruined, the walls and partitions crumbling away, kotis of vultures nestle in it, as well as doves, owls, and other birds. There are in every corner dreadful snakes, most venomous and horrible, scorpions and mice of all sorts. It is the abode of very wicked creatures of every description. Further, one may meet in it here and there beings not belonging to the human race. It is defiled with excrement and urine, and teeming with worms, insects, and fireflies. It resounds from the howling of dogs and jackals. In it are horrible hyenas that are wont to devour human carcasses, many dogs and jackals greedily seeking the matter of corpses. Those animals weak from perpetual hunger go about in several places to feed upon their prey, and quarreling, fill the spot with their cries, such as that most horrible house. There are also very malign goblins who violate human corpses. In several spots there are centipedes, huge snakes, and vipers. Those animals creep into all corners, where they make nests to deposit their brood, which is often devoured by the goblins. And when those cruel-minded goblins are satiated with feeding upon the flesh of other creatures, so that their bodies are big, then they commence sharply fighting on the spot. In the wasted retreats are dreadful, malign urchins, some of them measuring one span, others one cubit or two cubits, all nimble in their movements. They are in the habit of seizing dogs by the feet, throwing them upside down upon the floor, pinching their necks, and using them ill. There also live yelling ghosts, naked, black, wan, tall, and high, who, hungry and in quest of food, are here and there emitting cries of distress. Some have a mouth like a needle. Others have a face like a cow's. They are of the size of men or dogs, go with entangled hair, and utter plaintive cries from want of food. Those goblins, ghosts, imps, like vultures, are always looking out through the windows and loopholes in all directions in search of food. Such is that dreadful house, spacious and high, but very infirm, full of holes, frail and dreary. It is the property of a certain man, 56, and that while he is out of doors, the house is reached by a conflagration, so that on a sudden, it is wrapped in a blazing mass of fire on every side, the beams and rafters consumed by the fire, the columns and partitions in flame are crackling most dreadfully, whilst goblins and ghosts are yelling, vultures are driven out by hundreds, urchins withdraw with parched faces, hundreds of mischievous beasts of prey run, scorched on every side, crying and shouting. Many poor devils move about, burnt by the fire. While burning, they tear one another with the teeth and bespatter each other with their blood. 60. Hyenas also perish there, in the act of eating one another. The excrements burn, and a loathsome stench spreads in all directions. 61. The centipedes trying to fly are devoured by the urchins. The ghosts with burning hair hover about, equally vexed with hunger and heat. In such a state is that awful house, where thousands of flames are breaking out on every side. But the man who is the master of the house looks on from without, and he hears his own children, whose minds are engaged in playing with their toys, in their fondness of which they amuse themselves as fools do in their ignorance. And as he hears them, he quickly steps in to save his children, lest his ignorant children might perish in the flames. He tells them the defect of the house, and says, "This young man of good family is a miserable house, a dreadful one. The various creatures in it, and this fire to boot, form a series of evils. In it are snakes, mischievous goblins, urchins, and ghosts in great number, hyenas, troops of dogs and jackals, as well as vultures seeking their prey. Such beings live in this house, which, apart from the fire, is extremely dreadful and miserable enough, and now comes to it, this fire blazing on all sides. The foolish boys, however, though admonished, do not mind their father's words. Deluded as they are by their toys, they do not even understand him. Then the man thinks, I am now in anxiety on account of my children. What is the use of my having sons? If I lose them, no, they shall not perish by this fire. 70. Instantly a device occurred to his mind. These young and ignorant children are fond of toys and have none just now to play with. Oh, they are so foolish. He then says to them, listen, my sons. I have carts of different sorts, yoked with deer, goats, and excellent bullocks, lofty, great, and completely furnished. 72. They are outside the house, run out. Do with them what you like. For your sake have I caused them to be made.
run out altogether and rejoice to have them. All the boys, on hearing of such carts, exert themselves, immediately rush out hastily, and reach free from harm the open air. On seeing that the children have come out, the man betakes himself to the square in the center of the village, and there, from the throne he is sitting on, he says, "Good people, now I feel at ease. These poor sons of mine, whom I have recovered with difficulty. My own dear 20 young children were in a dreadful, wretched, horrible house full of many animals. As it was burning and wrapped in thousands of flames, they were amusing themselves in it with playing, but now I have rescued them all, therefore I now feel most happy." The children, seeing their father happy, approached him and said, "Dear father, give us, as you have promised, those nice vehicles of three kinds, and make true all that you promised us in the house when saying, 'I will give you three sorts of vehicles.' Do give them. It is now the right time. Now the man, as we have supposed, had a mighty treasure of gold, silver, precious stones, and pearls. He possessed bullion, numerous slaves, domestics, and vehicles of various kinds. 80. Carts made of precious substances, yoked with bullocks, most excellent, with benches, and a row of tinkling bells, decorated with umbrellas and flags, and adorned with a network of gems and pearls. 81. They are embellished with gold, and artificial wreaths hanging down here and there, covered all around with excellent cloth and fine white muslin. Those carts are moreover furnished with choice mattresses of fine silk, serving for cushions, and covered with choice carpets showing the images of cranes and swans, and worth thousands of kotis. The carts are yoked with white bullocks, well fed, strong, of great size, very fine, who are tended by numerous persons. 84. Such excellent carts that man gives to all his sons, who, overjoyed and charmed, go and play with them in all directions. In the same manner, Sariputra, I, the great seer, and the protector and father of all beings, and all creatures who, childlike, are captivated by the pleasures of the triple world, are my sons. This triple world is as dreadful as that house, overwhelmed with a number of evils, entirely inflamed on every side by 100 different sorts of birth, old age, and disease. But I, who am detached from the triple world and serene, am living in absolute retirement in a wood. This triple world is my domain, and those who in it are suffering from burning heat are my sons. And I told its evils because I had resolved upon saving them, but they would not listen to me because all of them were ignorant and their hearts attached to the pleasures of sense. Then I employ an able device and tell them of the three vehicles, so showing them the means of evading the numerous evils of the triple world which are known to me. 90. And those of my sons who adhere to me, who are mighty in the six transcendent faculties and the triple science, the Pratyeka Buddhas, as well as the Bodhisattvas, and able to slide back. 91. And those others who equally are my sons, to them I just now am showing, by means of this excellent allegory, the single Buddha vehicle. Receive it, ye shall all become Ginas. It is most excellent and sweet, the most exalted in the world, that knowledge of the Buddhas, the most high among men. It is something sublime and admirable. The powers, meditations, degrees of emancipation, and self-concentration, by many hundreds of kotis. That is the exalted vehicle in which the sons of Buddha take a never-ending delight. In playing with it, they pass days and nights, fortnights, months, seasons, years, intermediate kalpas, nay, thousands of kotis of kalpas. This is the lofty vehicle of jewels, which sundry bodhisattvas and the disciples listening to the sugata employ to go and sport on the terrace of enlightenment. Know then, Tishya, that there is no second vehicle in this world anywhere to be found, in whatever direction thou shalt search, apart from the device shown by the Most High among men. Ye are my children, I am your father, who has removed you from pain, from the triple world, from fear and danger, when you had been burning for many kotis of aeons. and I am teaching blessed rest, Nirvana. Insofar as thou, though you have not reached final rest, you are delivered from the trouble of the mundane world, provided you seek the vehicle of the Buddhas. Any bodhisattvas here present obey my Buddha rules. Such is the skillfulness of the Gina that he disciplines many bodhisattvas. 100. When the creatures in this world delight in low and contemptible pleasures, then the chief of the world, who always speaks the truth, indicates pain as the first great truth. And to those who are ignorant and too simple-minded to discover the root of that pain, I lay open the way. Awaking of full consciousness, strong desire is the origin of pain. Always try unattached to suppress desire. This is my third truth, that of suppression. It is an infallible means of deliverance, for by practicing this method one shall become emancipated. And from what are they emancipated, Sariputra? They are emancipated from chimeras, yet they are not wholly freed. The chief declares that they have not yet reached final and complete rest in this world. Why is it that I do not pronounce one to be delivered before one's having reached the highest supreme enlightenment? Because such is my will, I am the ruler of the law, who is born in this world to lead to beatitude. This, Sariputra, is the closing word of my law, which now, at the last time, I pronounce for the well of the world, including the gods. Preach it in all quarters. 106. And if someone speaks to you these words, I joyfully accept, and with signs of utmost reverence receives the sutra. Thou mayst consider that man to be unable to slide back. To believe in the sutra, one must have seen former Tathagatas, paid honor to them, and heard a law similar to this. To believe in my supreme word, one must have seen me. Thou and the assembly of monks have seen all these bodhisattvas. This sutra is apt to puzzle the ignorant, and I do not pronounce it before having penetrated to superior knowledge. Indeed, it is not within the range of the disciples, nor do the Pratyekabuddhas come to it. But thou, Sariputra, hast good will not to speak of my other disciples here. They will walk in my faith, though each cannot have his individual knowledge. But do not speak of this matter to haughty persons, nor to conceited ones, nor to yogins who are not self-restrained. For the fools, always reveling in sensual pleasures, might in their blindness scorn the law manifested. Now hear the dire results when one scorns my skillfulness and the Buddha rules forever fixed in the world, when one with sullen brow scorns the vehicle. Hear the destiny of those who have scorned such a sutra like this, whether during my lifetime or after my nirvana, or who have wronged the monks. After having disappeared from amongst men, they shall dwell in the lowest hell, Aviki, during a whole kalpa, and thereafter they shall fall lower and lower, the fools passing through repeated births for many intermediate kalpas. And when they have vanished from amongst the inhabitants of hell, they shall further descend to the condition of brutes, be even as dogs and jackals, and become a sport to others. Under such circumstances, they shall grow blackish of color, spotted, covered with sores, itchy. Moreover, they shall be hairless and feeble, all those who have an aversion to my supreme enlightenment. They are ever despised amongst animals. Hit by clods or weapons, they yell. Everywhere they are threatened with sticks, and their bodies are emaciated from hunger and thirst. 118. Sometimes they become camels or asses carrying loads and are beaten with whips and sticks. They are constantly occupied with thoughts of eating, the fools who have scorned the Buddha rule. At other times they become ugly jackals, half blind and crippled. The helpless creatures are vexed by the village boys who throw clods and weapons at them. 120. Again, shooting off from that place, those fools become animals with bodies of 500 yoganas, whirling round, dull and lazy. 121. They have no feet and creep on the belly. To be devoured by many kotis of animals is the dreadful punishment they have to suffer for having scorned a sutra like this. And whenever they assume a human shape, they are born crippled, maimed, crooked, one-eyed, blind, dull, and low. They have no faith in my sutra. 123. Nobody keeps their side. A putrid smell is continually issuing from their mouths. An evil spirit has entered the body of those who do not believe in this supreme enlightenment. Needy, obliged to do menial labor, always in another service. Feeble and subject to many diseases, they go about in the world unprotected. The man whom they happen to serve is unwilling to give them much, and what he gives is soon lost. Such is the fruit of sinfulness. Even the best prepared medicaments administered to them by able men do under those circumstances but increase their illness, and the disease has no end. Some commit thefts, affrays, assaults, or acts of hostility, whereas others commit robberies of goods. All this befalls the sinner. Never does he behold the Lord of the world, the King of Kings ruling the earth, for he is doomed to live at a wrong time, he who scorns my Buddha rule. Note, for he is doomed to live at a wrong time, in the darkness of hell, i.e. in common parlance, at night time when nobody can behold the sun. 129. Nor does that foolish person listen to the law. He is deaf and senseless. He never finds rest, because he has scorned this enlightenment. 130. During many hundred thousand myriads of kotis of aeons equal to the sand of the Ganges, he shall be dull and defective. That is the evil result from scorning the sutra. Hell is his garden or monastery, a place of misfortune, his abode. He is continually living amongst asses, hogs, jackals, and dogs. And when he has assumed a human shape, he is to be blind, deaf, and stupid, the servant of another, and always poor. Diseases, myriads of kotis of wounds on the body, scab, itch, scurf, leprosy, blotch, a foul smell, are, in that condition, his covering and apparel. His sight is dim to distinguish the real. His anger appears mighty in him, and his passion is most violent. He always delights in animal wounds. Were I to go on, Sariputra, for a whole aeon enumerating the evils of him who shall scorn my sutra, I should not come to an end. And since I am fully aware of it, I command thee, Sariputra, that thou shalt not expound a sutra like this before foolish people, but those who are sensible, instructed, thoughtful, clever, and learned, who strive after the highest supreme enlightenment, to them expound its real meaning. Those who have seen many kotis of Buddhas, planted immeasurably many roots of goodness, and undertaken a strong vow, to them expound its real meaning. Those who, full of energy and ever kind-hearted, have a long time been developing the feeling of kindness, have given up body and life, in their presence thou mayest preach this sutra. Those who show mutual love and respect, keep no intercourse with ignorant people, and are content to live in mountain caverns, to them expound this hallowed sutra. 141. If thou see sons of Buddha who attach themselves to virtuous friends and avoid bad friends, then reveal to them this sutra. Those sons of Buddha who have not broken the moral vows are pure like gems and jewels and devoted to the study of the great sutras. Before those thou mayst propound the sutra. Those who are not irascible, ever sincere, full of compassion for all living beings, and respectful towards the Sugata, before those thou mayst propound the sutra. To one who in the congregation, without any hesitation and distraction of mind, speaks to expound the law with many myriads of kotis of illustrations, thou mayst manifest this sutra. And he who, desirous of acquiring all knowingness, respectfully lifts his jointed hands to his head, or who seeks in all directions to find some monk of sacred eloquence, and he who keeps in memory the great sutras, while he never shows any liking for other books, nor even knows a single stanza from another work, to all of them thou mayst expound this sublime sutra. He who seeks such an excellent sutra as this, and after obtaining it, devoutly worships it, is like the man who wears a relic of the Tathagata he has eagerly sought for. Never mind other sutras nor other books in which a profane philosophy is taught. Such books are fit for the foolish. Avoid them and preach this sutra. During a full aeon, Sariputra, I could speak of thousands of kotis of connected points. But this suffices. Thou mayest reveal this sutra to all who are striving after the highest supreme enlightenment. Chapter 4. Disposition. As the Venerable Subhuti, the Venerable Mahakatyayana, the Venerable Mahakasyapa, and the Venerable Mahamaudgalyayana heard this law unheard of before, and as from the mouth of the Lord they heard the future destiny of Sariputra to superior perfect enlightenment, they were struck with wonder, amazement, and rapture. They instantly rose from their seats and went up to the place where the Lord was sitting. After throwing their cloak over one shoulder, fixing the right knee on the ground, and lifting up their joined hands before the Lord, looking up to him, their bodies bent down and inclined, they addressed the Lord in this strain. Lord, we are old, aged, advanced in years, honored as seniors in this assemblage of monks, worn out by old age, we fancy that we have attained nirvana. We make no efforts, O Lord, for supreme perfect enlightenment. Our force and exertion are inadequate to it. Though the Lord preaches the law and has long continued sitting, and though we have attended to that preaching of the law, yet, O Lord, as we have so long been sitting and so long attended the Lord's service, our greater and minor members, as well as the joints and articulations, begin to ache. Hence, O Lord, we are unable, in spite of the Lord's preaching, to realize the fact that all is vanity or void, purposeless or causeless or unconditioned and unfixed. We have conceived no longing after the Buddha laws, the divisions of the Buddha fields, the sports of the Bodhisattvas or Tathagatas. For by having fled out of the triple world, O Lord, we imagined having attained nirvana, and we are decrepit from old age. Hence, O Lord, though we have exhorted other Bodhisattvas and instructed them in supreme perfect enlightenment, we have, in doing so, never conceived a single thought of longing. And just now, O Lord, we are hearing from the Lord that disciples also may be predestined to supreme perfect enlightenment. We are astonished and amazed and deem it a great gain, O Lord, that today, on a sudden, we have heard from the Lord a voice such as we never heard before. We have acquired a magnificent jewel, O Lord, an incomparable jewel. We had not sought, nor searched, nor expected, nor required so magnificent a jewel. It has become clear to us, O Lord, it has become clear to us, O Sugata. It is a case, O Lord, as if a certain man went away from his father and betook himself to some other place. He lives there in foreign parts for many years, 20 or 30 or 40 or 50. In course of time, the one, the father, becomes a great man. The other, the son, is poor. In seeking a livelihood for the sake of food and clothing, he roams in all directions and goes to some place, whereas his father removes to another country. The latter has much wealth, gold, corn, treasures, and granaries, possesses much wrought gold and silver, many gems, pearls, lapis lazuli, conch shells and stones, corals, gold and silver, many slaves, male and female, servants for menial work and journeymen, is rich in elephants, horses, carriages, cows, and sheep. He keeps a large retinue, has his money invested in great territories, and does great things in business, money lending, agriculture, and commerce. In course of time, Lord, that poor man, in quest of food and clothing, roaming through villages, towns, boroughs, provinces, kingdoms, and royal capitals, reaches the place where his father, the owner of much wealth and gold, treasures and granaries, is residing. Now, the poor man's father, Lord, the owner of much wealth and gold, treasures and granaries, who was residing in that town, had always and ever been thinking of the son he had lost 50 years ago, but he gave no utterance to his thoughts before others, and was only pining in himself and thinking, I'm old, aged, advanced in years, and possess abundance of bullion, gold, money and corn, treasures and granaries, but have no son. It is to be feared lest death shall overtake me and all this perish unused. Repeatedly, he was thinking of that son. Oh, how happy I should be were my son to enjoy this mass of wealth. Meanwhile, Lord, the poor man in search of food and clothing was gradually approaching the house of the rich man, the owner of abundant bullion, gold, money and corn, treasures and granaries. And the father of the poor man happened to sit at the door of his house, surrounded and waited upon by a great crowd of Brahmins, Kshatriyas, Vaisyas, and Sudras. He was sitting on a magnificent throne with a footstool decorated with gold and silver, while dealing with 100,000s of kotis of gold pieces, and fanned with a chowri on a spot under an extended awning inlaid with pearls and flowers and adorned with hanging garlands of jewels, sitting, in short, in great pomp. The poor man, Lord, saw his own father in such pomp, sitting at the door of the house surrounded with a great crowd of people, and doing a householder's business. The poor man, frightened, terrified, alarmed, seized with a feeling of horripilation all over the body, and agitated in mind, reflects thus, unexpectedly have I here fallen in with a king or grandee. People like me have nothing to do here. Let me go. In the street of the poor, I am likely to find food and clothing without much difficulty. Let me no longer tarry at this place, lest I be taken to do forced labor or incur some other injury. Thereupon, Lord, the poor man quickly departs, runs off, does not tarry from fear of a series of supposed dangers. But the rich man, sitting on the throne at the door of his mansion, has recognized his son at first sight, in consequence whereof he is content, in high spirits, charmed, delighted, filled with joy and cheerfulness. He thinks, wonderful. He who is to enjoy this plenty of bullion, gold, money and corn, treasures and granaries, has been found. He of whom I have been thinking again and again is here now that I am old, aged, advanced in years. At the same time, moment and instant, Lord, he dispatches couriers to whom he says, go, sirs, and quickly fetch me that man. The fellows thereon all run forth in full speed and overtake the poor man, who, frightened, terrified, alarmed, seized with a feeling of horrifilation all over his body, agitated in mind, utters a lamentable cry of distress, screams, and exclaims, I have given you no offense, but the fellows drag the poor man, however lamenting, violently with them. He, frightened, terrified, alarmed, seized with a feeling of horripilation all over his body and agitated mind, thinks by himself, I fear lest I shall be punished with capital punishment. I am lost. He faints away and falls in the earth. His father, dismayed and near despondency, says to those fellows, do not carry the man in that manner. With those words, he sprinkles him with cold water without addressing him any further. For that householder knows the poor man's humble disposition and his own elevated position, yet he feels that the man is his son. The householder, Lord, skillfully conceals from everyone that it is his son. He calls one of his servants and says to him, go, sirrah, and tell that poor man, go, sirrah, whither thou likest, thou art free. The servant obeys, approaches the poor man, and tells him, go, sirrah, whither thou likest, thou art free. The poor man is astonished and amazed at hearing these words. He leaves that spot and wanders to the street of the poor in search of food and clothing. In order to attract him, the householder practices an able device. He employs for it two men ill-favored and of little splendor. Go, says he, go to the man you saw in this place, hire him in your own name for a double daily fee, and order him to do work here in my house. And if he asks, what work shall I have to do? Tell him, help us in clearing the heap of dirt. The two fellows go and seek the poor man and engage him for such work as mentioned. Thereupon, the two fellows conjointly with the poor man clear the heap of dirt in the house for the daily pay they receive from the rich man, while they take up their abode in a hovel of straw in the neighborhood of the rich man's dwelling. And that rich man beholds through a window his own son clearing the heap of dirt, at which sight he is anew struck with wonder and astonishment. Then the householder descends from his mansion, lays off his wreath and ornaments, parts with his soft, clean, and gorgeous attire, puts on dirty raiment, takes a basket in his right hand, smears his body with dust, and goes to his son, whom he greets from afar and thus addresses, "Please, take the baskets and without delay remove the dust." By this device he manages to speak to his son, to have a talk with him, and say, "Do, sirrah, remain here in my service. Do not go again to another place. I will give thee extra pay, and whatever thou wantest, thou mayest confidently ask me, be it the price of a pot, a smaller pot, a boiler, or wood, or be it the price of salt, food, or clothing. I have got an old cloak, man. If thou shouldest want it, ask me for it, I will give it. Any utensil of such sort, when thou wantest to have it, I will give thee. Be at ease, fellow. Look upon me as if I were thy father, for I am older and thou art younger, and thou hast rendered me much service by clearing this heap of dirt. And as long as thou hast been in my service, thou hast never shown nor art showing wickedness, crookedness, arrogance, or hypocrisy. I have discovered in thee no vice at all of such as are commonly seen in other manservants. From henceforward thou art to me like my own son." From that time, Lord, the householder addresses the poor man by the name of son, and the latter feels in presence of the householder as a son to his father. In this manner, Lord, the householder, affected with longing for his son, employs him for the clearing of the heap of dirt during 20 years, at the end of which the poor man feels quite at ease in the mansion to go in and out, though he continues taking his abode in the hovel of straw. After a while, Lord, the householder falls sick and feels that the time of his death is near at hand. He says to the poor man, "Come hither, man. I possess abundant bullion, gold, money, and corn, treasures, and granaries. I am very sick and wish to have one upon whom to bestow my wealth, by whom it is to be received and with whom it is to be deposited. Accept it, for in the same manner as I am the owner of it, so art thou, but thou shalt not suffer anything of it to be wasted." And so, Lord, the poor man accepts the abundant bullion, gold, money, and corn, treasures, and granaries of the rich man, but for himself he is quite indifferent to it, and requires nothing from it, not even so much as the price of a prastha of flour. He continues living in the same hovel of straw, and considers himself as poor as before. After a while, Lord, the householder perceives that his son is able to save, mature, and mentally developed, that in the consciousness of his nobility, he feels abashed, ashamed, disgusted when thinking of his former poverty. The time of his death approaching, he sends for the poor man, presents him to a gathering of his relations, and before the king or king's peer, and in the presence of citizens and country people, makes the following speech: "Here, gentlemen, this is my own son, by me begotten. It is now 50 years that he disappeared from such and such a town. He is called so and so, and myself am called so and so. In searching after him, I have from that town come hither. He is my son, I am his father. To him I leave all my revenues and all my personal or private wealth, shall he acknowledge his own?" The poor man, Lord, hearing the speech, was astonished and amazed. He thought by himself, "Unexpectedly have I obtained this bullion, gold, money, and corn, treasuries, and granaries." Even so, O Lord, do we represent the sons of the Tathagata. And the Tathagata says to us, "Ye are my sons," as the householder did. We were oppressed, O Lord, with three difficulties, namely the difficulty of pain, the difficulty of conceptions, the difficulty of transition or evolution, and in the worldly whirl, we were disposed to what is low. Then have we been prompted by the Lord to ponder on the numerous inferior laws or conditions, things, that are similar to a heap of dirt. Once directed to them, we have been practicing, making efforts, and seeking for nothing but nirvana as our fee. We were content, O Lord, with the nirvana obtained, and thought to have gained much at the hands of the Tathagata, because of our having applied ourselves to these laws, practiced, and made efforts. But the Lord takes no notice of us, does not mix with us, nor tell us that this treasure of the Tathagata's knowledge shall belong to us, though the Lord skillfully appoints us as heirs to this treasure of the knowledge of the Tathagata. And we, O Lord, are not impatiently longing to enjoy it, because we deem it a great gain already to receive from the Lord Nirvana as our fee. We preach to the Bodhisattvas, Mahasattvas, a sublime sermon about the knowledge of the Tathagata. We explain, show, demonstrate the knowledge of the Tathagata. O Lord, without longing, for the Tathagata by his skillfulness knows our disposition, whereas we ourselves do not know nor apprehend. It is for this very reason that the Lord just now tells us that we are to him as sons, and that he reminds us of being heirs to the Tathagata. For the case stands thus: we are as sons to the Tathagata, but low, or humble, of disposition. The Lord perceives the strength of our disposition and applies to us the denomination of Bodhisattvas. We are, however, charged with a double office insofar as in presence of Bodhisattvas we are called persons of low disposition, and at the same time have to rouse them to Buddha enlightenment. Knowing the strength of our disposition, the Lord has thus spoken, and in this way, O Lord, do we say that we have obtained unexpectedly and without longing the jewel of omniscience, which we did not desire, nor seek, nor search after, nor expect, nor require, and that inasmuch we are the sons of the Tathagata? On that occasion, the venerable Maha Kasyapa uttered the following stanzas. 1. We are stricken with wonder, amazement, and rapture at hearing a voice. It is the lovely voice, the leader's voice, that so unexpectedly we hear today. In a short moment we have acquired a great heap of precious jewels, such as we were not thinking of nor requiring. All of us are astonished to hear it. It is like the history of a young person who, seduced by foolish people, went away from his father and wandered to another country far distant. The father was sorry to perceive that his son had run away, and in his sorrow roamed the country in all directions during no less than 50 years. In search of his son, he came to some great city where he built a house and dwelt, blessed with all that can gratify the five senses. He had plenty of bullion and gold, money and corn, conch shells, stones and coral, elephants, horses and footboys, cows, cattle and sheep, interests, revenues, landed properties, male and female slaves, and a great number of servants, was highly honored by thousands of Kotis and a constant favorite of the kings. The citizens bow to him with joined hands, as well as the villagers in the rural districts. Many merchants come to him and persons charged with numerous affairs. In such way, the man becomes wealthy, but he gets old, aged, advanced in years, and he passes days and nights always sorrowful in mind on account of his son. 10. It is 50 years since that foolish son has run away. I have got plenty of wealth, and the hour of my death draws near. Meanwhile, that foolish son is wandering from village to village, poor and miserable, seeking food and clothing. When begging, he at one time gets something, another time he does not. He grows lean in his travels, the unwise boy, while his body is vitiated with scabs and itch. In course of time, he, in his rovings, reaches the town where his father is living, and comes to his father's mansion to beg for food and raiment. And the wealthy rich man happens to sit at the door on a throne under a canopy expanded in the sky and surrounded with many hundreds of living beings. His trustees stand around him, some of them counting money in bullion, some writing bills, some lending money on interest. The poor man, seeing the splendid mansion of the householder, thinks within himself, "Where am I here? This man must be a king or a grandee. Let me not incur some injury and be caught to do forced labor." With these reflections, he hurried away, inquiring after the road to the street of the poor. The rich man on the throne is glad to see his own son and dispatches messengers with the order to fetch that poor man. The messengers immediately seize the man, but he is no sooner caught than he faints away as he thinks, "These are certainly executioners who have approached me. What do I want? Clothing or food?" 20. On seeing it, the rich, sagacious man thinks, "This ignorant and stupid person is of low disposition and will have no faith in my magnificence, nor believe that I am his father." Under those circumstances, he orders persons of low character, crooked, one-eyed, maimed, ill-clad, and blackish, to go and search that man who shall do menial work. "Enter my service and cleanse the putrid heap of dirt, replete with feces and urine. I will give thee a double salary," are the words of the message. On hearing this call, the poor man comes and cleans the said spot. He takes up his abode there in a hovel near the mansion. The rich man continually observes him through the windows and thinks, "There is my son engaged in a low occupation, cleansing the heap of dirt." Then he descends, takes a basket, puts on dirty garments, and goes near the man. He chides him, saying, "Thou dost not perform thy work. I will give thee double salary and twice more ointment for the feet. I will give thee food with salt, pot herbs, and besides a cloak." So he chides him at the time, but afterwards he wisely conciliates him by saying, "Thou dost thy work very well indeed. Thou art my son, surely there is no doubt of it." Little by little, he makes the man enter the house and employs him in his service for fully 20 years, in the course of which time he succeeds in inspiring him with confidence. At the same time, he lays up in the house gold, pearls, and crystal, draws up the sum total, and is always occupied in his mind with all that property. 30. The ignorant man who is living outside the mansion alone in a hovel cherishes no other ideas but of poverty and thinks to himself, "Mine are no such possessions." The rich man, perceiving this of him, thinks, "My son has arrived at the consciousness of being noble." He calls together a gathering of his friends and relatives and says, "I will give all my property to this man." In the midst of the assembly where the king, burghers, citizens, and many merchantmen were present, he speaks thus, "This is my son whom I lost a long time ago. It is now fully 50 years and 20 years more during which I have seen him. That he disappeared from such and such a place, and that in his search I came to this place. He is owner of all my property. To him I leave it all and entirely. Let him do with it what he wants. I give him my whole family property." And the poor man is struck with surprise, remembering his former poverty, his low disposition, and as he receives those good things of his father's and the family property, he thinks, "Now am I a happy man." 36. In like manner has the leader who knows our low disposition or position not declared to us, "Ye shall become Buddhas, but ye are certainly my disciples and sons." And the Lord of the world enjoins us, "Teach, Kasyapa, the superior path to those that strive to attain the highest summit of enlightenment the path by following which they are to become Buddhas. Being thus ordered by the Sugata, we show the path to many bodhisattvas of great might by means of myriads of kotis of illustrations and proofs. And by hearing us, the sons of Gina realize that eminent path to attain enlightenment, and in that case receive the prediction that they are to become Buddhas in this world. 40. Such is the work we are doing strenuously, preserving this law treasure and revealing it to the sons of Gina in the manner of that man who had deserved the confidence of that other man. 41. Yet though we diffuse the Buddha treasure, we feel ourselves to be poor. We do not require the knowledge of the Gina, and yet at the same time we reveal it. We fancy an individual nirvana. So far, no further does our knowledge reach, nor do we ever rejoice at hearing of the divisions of Buddha fields. All these laws are faultless, unshaken, exempt from destruction and commencement, but there is no law in them. When we hear this, however, we cannot believe. We have put aside all aspiration to superior Buddha knowledge a long time ago. Never have we devoted ourselves to it. This is the last and decisive word spoken by the Gina. In this bodily existence, closing with nirvana, we have continually accustomed our thoughts to the void. We have been released from the evils of the triple world we were suffering from, and have accomplished the command of the Gina. To whomsoever among the sons of Gina, who in this world are on the road to superior enlightenment, we revealed the law, and whatever law we taught, we never had any predilection for it. And the master of the world, the self-born one, takes no notice of us, waiting his time. He does not explain the real connection of the things as he is testing our disposition. Able in applying devices at the right time, like that rich man, he says, be constant in subduing your low disposition, and to those who are subdued he gives his wealth. It is a very difficult task which the Lord of the world is performing, a task in which he displays his skillfulness when he tames his sons of low disposition, and thereupon imparts to them his knowledge. 50. On a sudden have we today been seized with surprise, just as the poor man who acquired riches, now for the first time have we obtained the fruit under the rule of Buddha, a fruit as excellent as faultless. As we have always observed the moral precepts under the rule of the knower of the world, we now receive the fruit of that morality which we have formerly practiced. Now have we obtained the egregious, hallowed, exalted, and perfect fruit of our having observed an excellent and pure spiritual life under the rule of the leader. Now, O Lord, are we disciples, and we shall proclaim supreme enlightenment everywhere, reveal the word of enlightenment by which we are formidable disciples. Now have we become arhats, O Lord, and deserving of the worship of the world, including the gods, Maras, and Brahmas, in short, of all beings. Who is there, even were he to exert himself during kotis of aeons, able to thwart thee? Who accomplishes in this world of mortals such difficult things as those, and others even more difficult? It would be difficult to offer resistance with hands, feet, head, shoulder, or breast, even were one to try, during as many complete aeons as there are grains of sand in the Ganges. One may charitably give food, soft and solid, clothing, drink, a place for sleeping and sitting, with clean coverlets. One may build monasteries of sandalwood, and after furnishing them with double pieces of fine white muslin, present them. One may be assiduous in giving medicines of various kinds to the sick in honor of the Sugata. One may spend alms during as many aeons as there are grains of sand in the Ganges. Even then one will not be able to offer resistance of sublime nature, unequaled power, miraculous might, firm in the strength of patience as the Buddha, A great ruler is the Gina, free from imperfections. The ignorant cannot bear or understand such things as these. 60. Always returning, he preaches the law to those whose course of life is conditioned. He, the Lord of the law, the Lord of all the world, the great Lord, the chief among the leaders of the world, fully aware of the circumstances or places of all beings, he indicates their duties, so multifarious, and considering the variety of their dispositions, he inculcates the law with thousands of arguments. He, the Tathagata, who is fully aware of the course of all beings and individuals, preaches a multifarious law while pointing to the superior enlightenment.
Chapter 5 On Plants. Thereupon the Lord addressed the venerable Maha Kasyapa and the other senior great disciples and said, very well, Kasyapa. You have done very well to proclaim the real qualities of the Tathagata. They are the real qualities of the Tathagata, Kasyapa, but he has many more, innumerable, incalculable, the end of which it would be difficult to reach, even were one to continue enumerating them for immeasurable aeons. The Tathagata, Kasyapa, is the master of the law, the king, lord, and master of all laws. And whatever law for any case has been instituted by the Tathagata remains unchanged. All laws, Kasyapa, have been aptly instituted by the Tathagata. In his Tathagata wisdom, he has instituted them in such a manner that all those laws finally lead to the stage of those who know all. The Tathagata also distinctly knows the meaning of all laws. The Tathagata, the Arhat, is possessed of the faculty of penetrating all laws, possessed of the highest perfection of knowledge, so that he is able to decide all laws, able to display the knowledge of the all-knowing, impart the knowledge of the all-knowing, and lay down the rules of the knowledge of the all-knowing. It is a case, Kasyapa, similar to that of a great cloud big with rain coming up in this wide universe over all grasses, shrubs, herbs, trees of various species and kind, families of plants of different names growing on earth, on hills, or in mountain caves, a cloud covering the wide universe to pour down its rain everywhere and at the same time. Then, Kasyapa, the grasses, shrubs, herbs, and wild trees in this universe, such as have young and tender stalks, twigs, leaves, and foliage, and such as have middle-sized stalks, twigs, leaves, and foliage, and such as have the same fully developed, all those grasses, shrubs, herbs, and wild trees, smaller and greater, other trees, will each, according to its faculty and power, suck the humid element from the water emitted by that great cloud, and by that water which, all of one essence, has been abundantly poured down by the cloud, they will each, according to its germ, acquire a regular development, growth, shooting up, and bigness, and so they will produce blossoms and fruits, and will receive each severally their names. Rooted in one and the same soil, all those families of plants and germs are drenched and vivified by water of one essence throughout. In the same manner, Kasyapa, does the Tathagata, the Arhat, etc., appear in the world like unto a great cloud coming up. The Tathagata appears and sends forth his call to the whole world, including gods, men, and demons. And even as a great cloud, Kasyapa, extending over the whole universe in like manner, Kasyapa, the Tathagata, the Arhat, etc., before the face of the world, including gods, men, and demons, lifts his voice and utters these words. I am the Tathagata, O ye gods and men. The Arhat, the perfectly enlightened one, having reached the shore myself, I carry others to the shore. Being free, I make free. Being comforted, I comfort. Being perfectly at rest, I lead others to rest. By my perfect wisdom, I know both this world and the next, such as they really are. I am all-knowing, all-seeing. Come to me, ye gods and men, hear the law. I am he who indicates the path, who shows the path, as knowing the path, being acquainted with the path. Then Kasyapa, many hundred thousand myriads of kotis of beings come to hear the law of the Tathagata, and the Tathagata, who knows the difference as to the faculties and the energy of those beings, produces various dharma pariyayas,
tells many tales, amusing, agreeable, both instructive and pleasant, tales by means of which all beings not only become pleased with the law in this present life, but also after death will reach happy states, where they are to enjoy many pleasures and hear the law. By listening to the law, they will be freed from hindrances, and in due course apply themselves to the law of the all-knowing according to their faculty, power, and strength. Even as the great cloud, Kasyapa, after expanding over the whole universe, pours out the same water and recreates by it all grasses, shrubs, herbs, and trees, even as all these grasses, shrubs, herbs, and trees, according to their faculty, power, and strength, suck in the water and thereby attain the full development assigned to their kind, in like manner, Kasyapa, is the law preached by the Tathagata, the Arhat, etc., of one and the same essence, that is to say, the essence of it is deliverance, the final aim being absence of passion, annihilation, knowledge of the all-knowing. As to that, Kasyapa, it must be understood that the beings who hear the law when it is preached by the Tathagata, who keep it in their memory and apply themselves to it, do not know, nor perceive, nor understand their own self. For Kasyapa, the Tathagata only really knows who, how, and of what kind those beings are, what, how, and whereby they are meditating, what, how, and whereby they are contemplating, what, why, and whereby they are attaining. No one but the Tathagata, Kasyapa, is there present, seeing all intuitively and seeing the state of those beings in different stages as of the lowest, highest, and mean grasses, shrubs, herbs, and trees. I am he, Kasyapa, who, knowing the law which is of but one essence, the essence of deliverance, the law ever peaceful, ending in nirvana, the law of eternal rest, having but one stage and placed in voidness, who, knowing this, do not on a sudden reveal to all the knowledge of the all-knowing, since I pay regard to the disposition of all beings. You are astonished, Kasyapa, that you cannot fathom the mystery expounded by the Tathagata. It is, Kasyapa, because the mystery expounded by the Tathagatas, the Arhats, etc., is difficult to be understood. And on that occasion, the more fully to explain the same subject, the Lord uttered the following stanzas. 1. I am the Dharma Raga. Born in the world as the destroyer of existence, I declare the law to all beings after discriminating their dispositions. 2. Superior men of wise understanding, guard the word, guard the mystery, and do not reveal it to living beings. That science is difficult to be understood. The simple, if hearing it on a sudden, would be perplexed. They would in their ignorance fall out of the way and go astray. I speak according to their reach and faculty. By means of various meanings, I accommodate my view or the theory. It is, Kasyapa, as if a cloud rising above the horizon shrouds all space in darkness and covers the earth. That great rain cloud, big with water, is wreathed with flashes of lightning and rouses with its thundering call all creatures. By warding off the sunbeams, it cools the region and gradually lowering, so as to come in reach of hands, it begins pouring down its water all around, and so, flashing on every side, it pours out an abundant mass of water equally and refreshes this earth. And all herbs which have sprung up on the face of the earth, all grasses, shrubs, forest trees, and other trees, small and great, 10, the various field fruits and whatever is green, all plants on hills, in caves, and thickets, stanza 11, all those grasses, shrubs, and trees are vivified by the cloud that both refreshes the thirsty earth and waters the herbs. Grasses and shrubs absorb the water of one essence which issues from the cloud according to their faculty and reach. And all trees, great, small, and mean, drink that water according to their growth and faculty and grow lustily. The great plants whose trunk, stalk, bark, twigs, pith, and leaves are moistened by the water from the cloud develop their blossoms and fruits. They yield their products, each according to its own faculty, reach, and the particular nature of the germ. Still, the water emitted from the cloud is of but one essence. In the same way, Kasyapa, the Buddha comes into the world like a rain cloud, and once born, he, the world's lord, speaks and shows the real course of life. And the great seer, honored in the world,
including the gods, speaks thus: I am the Tathagata, the highest of men, the Gina. I have appeared in this world like a cloud. I shall refresh all beings whose bodies are withered, who are clogged to the triple world. I shall bring to felicity those that are pining away with toils, give them pleasures and final rest. Hearken to me, ye hosts of gods and men, approach to behold me. I am the Tathagata, the Lord, who has no superior, who appears in this world to save. Stanza 20. To thousands of kotis of living beings, I preach a pure and most bright law that has but one scope, to wit, deliverance and rest. I preach with ever the same voice, constantly taking enlightenment as my text. For this is equal for all. No partiality is in it, neither hatred nor affection. I am inexorable, bear no love nor hatred towards anyone, and proclaim the law to all creatures without distinction, to the one as well as the other. Whether walking, standing, or sitting, I am exclusively occupied with this task of proclaiming the law. I never get tired of sitting on the chair I have ascended. I recreate the whole world like a cloud shedding its water without distinction. I have the same feelings for respectable people as for the low, for moral persons as for the immoral, for the depraved as for those who observe the rules of good conduct, for those who hold sectarian views and unsound tenets as for those whose views are sound and correct. I preach the law to the inferior in mental culture as well as to persons of superior understanding and extraordinary faculties, inaccessible to weariness. I spread in season the reign of the law. After hearing me, each according to his faculty, the several beings find their determined place in various situations amongst gods, men, beautiful beings, amongst Indras, Brahmas, or the monarchs, rulers of the universe. Here now I am going to explain what is meant by those plants of different size, some of them being low in the world, others middle-sized and great. Small plants are called the men who walk in the knowledge of the law, which is free from evil after the attaining of nirvana, who possess the six transcendent faculties and the triple science. Stanza 30. Mean plants are called the men who, dwelling in mountain caverns, covet the state of a Pratyeka Buddha and whose intelligence is moderately purified. Those who aspire to become leading men, thinking, I will become a Buddha, a chief of gods and men, and who practice exertion and meditation, are called the highest plants. But the sons of Sugata, who sedulously practice benevolence and a peaceful conduct, who have arrived at certainty about their being leading men, these are called trees. Those who move forward the wheel that never rolls back and with manly strength stand firm in the exercise of miraculous power, releasing many kotis of beings, those are called great trees. Yet it is one and the same law which is preached by the Gina, like the water emitted by the cloud is one and the same. Different only are the faculties as described, just as the plants on the face of the earth. By this parable thou mayest understand the skillfulness of the Tathagata, how he preaches one law, the various developments whereof may be likened to drops of rain. I also pour out rain, the rain of the law by which this whole world is refreshed, and each according to his faculty takes to heart this well-spoken law that is one in its essence. 37. Even as all grasses and shrubs, as well as plants of middle size, trees and great trees, at the time of rain, look bright in all quarters, so it is the very nature of the law to promote the everlasting well of the world. By the law, the whole world is recreated, and as the plants, when refreshed, expand their blossoms, the world does the same when refreshed. The plants that in their growth remain middle-sized are arhats, stopping when they have overcome frailties, and the Pratyeka Buddhas who, living in woody thickets, accomplish this well-spoken law. But the many bodhisattvas who, thoughtful and wise, go their way all over the triple world, striving after supreme enlightenment, they continue increasing in growth like trees. 41. Those who, endowed with magical powers and being adepts in the 4 degrees of meditation, feel delight
and hearing of complete voidness and emit thousands of rays. They are called the great trees on earth. So then Kasyapa is the preaching of the law, like the water poured out by the cloud everywhere alike, by which plants and men thrive, endless and eternal blossoms are produced. I reveal the law which has its cause in itself. At due time I show Buddha enlightenment. This is my supreme skillfulness and that of all leaders of the world. What I here say is true in the highest sense of the word. All my disciples attain nirvana. By following the sublime path of enlightenment, all my disciples shall become Buddhas. And further, Kasyapa, the Tathagata, in his educating creatures is equal, i.e. impartial and not unequal, i.e. partial. As the light of the sun and moon, Kasyapa shines upon all the world, upon the virtuous and the wicked, upon high and low, upon the fragrant and the ill-smelling, as their beams are sent down upon everything equally without inequality or partiality. So too, Kasyapa, the intellectual light of the knowledge of the omniscient, the Tathagatas, the Arhats, and so on, the preaching of the true law, proceeds equally in respect to all beings in the five states of existence, to all who, according to their particular disposition, are devoted to the great vehicle, or to the vehicle of the Pratika Buddhas, or to the vehicle of the disciples. Nor is there any deficiency or excess in the brightness of the Tathagata knowledge up to one's becoming fully acquainted with the law. There are not three vehicles, Kasyapa. There are but beings who act differently. Therefore, it is declared that there are three vehicles. When the Lord had thus spoken, the venerable Maha Kasyapa said to him, Lord, if there are not three vehicles, for what reason then is the designation of disciples, Shravakas, Buddhas, and Bodhisattvas kept up in the present times? On this speech, the Lord answered the venerable Maha Kasyapa as follows. It is, Kasyapa, as if a potter made different vessels out of the same clay. Some of those pots are to contain sugar, others ghee, others curds and milk, others of inferior quality are vessels of impurity. There is no diversity in the clay used. No, the diversity of the pots is only due to the substances which are put into each of them. In like manner, Kasyapa, is there but one vehicle, the Buddha vehicle? There is no second vehicle, no third. The Lord having thus spoken, the venerable Maha Kasyapa said, Lord, if the beings are of different disposition, will there be, for those who have left the triple world, one nirvana, or two, or three? The Lord replied, Nirvana, Kasyapa, is a consequence of understanding that all laws, things, are equal. Hence, there is but one nirvana, not two, not three. Therefore, Kasyapa, I will tell thee a parable, for men of good understanding will generally readily enough catch the meaning of what is taught under the shape of a parable. It is a case, Kasyapa, similar to that of a certain blind-born man who says, there are no handsome or ugly shapes. There are no men able to see handsome or ugly shapes. There exists no sun nor moon. There are no asterisms nor planets. There are no men able to see planets. But other persons say to the blind born, there are handsome and ugly shapes. There are men able to see handsome and ugly shapes. There is a sun and moon. There are asterisms and planets. There are men able to see planets. But the blind born does not believe them nor accept what they say. Now there is a physician who knows all diseases. He sees that blind-born man and makes to himself this reflection. The disease of this man originates in his sinful actions in former times. All diseases possible to arise are fourfold: rheumatical, cholerical, phlegmatical, and caused by a complication of the corrupted humors. The physician, after thinking again and again on a means to cure the disease, makes to himself this reflection. Surely, with the drugs in common use, it is impossible to cure this disease, but there are in the Himalaya, the king of mountains, four herbs, to wit, first, one called possessed of all sorts of colors and flavors. Second, delivering from all diseases. Third, delivering from all poisons. Fourth, procuring happiness to those standing in the right place. As the physician feels compassion for the blind-born man, he contrives some device to get to the Himalaya, the king of mountains. There he goes up and down and across to search. In doing so, he finds the four herbs. One he gives after chewing it with the teeth, another after pounding, another after having it mixed with another drug and boiled, another after having it mixed with a raw drug, another after piercing with a lancet somewhere a vein, another after singeing it in fire, another after combining it with various other substances so as to enter in a compound, potion, food, etc. Owing to these means being applied, the blind-born recovers his eyesight, and in consequence of that recovery, he sees outwardly and inwardly, far and near, the shine of sun and moon, the asterisms, planets, and all phenomena. Then he says, "Oh, how foolish was I that I did not believe what they told me, nor accepted what they affirmed. Now I see all, I am delivered from my blindness and have recovered my eyesight. There is none in the world who could surpass me." And at that same moment, seers of the five transcendent faculties, strong in the divine sight and hearing, in the knowledge of others' minds, in the memory of former abodes, in magical science and intuition, speak to the man thus, "Good man, thou hast just recovered thine eyesight, nothing more, and dost not know yet anything. Whence comes this conceitedness to thee? Thou hast no wisdom, nor art thou a clever man." Further, they say to him, "Good man, when sitting in the interior of thy room, thou canst not see nor distinguish forms outside, nor discern which beings are animated with kind feelings and which with hostile feelings. Thou canst not distinguish nor hear at the distance of five yoganas the voice of a man or the sound of a drum, conch trumpet, and the like. Thou canst not even walk as far as a koss without lifting up thy feet. Thou hast been produced and developed in thy mother's womb without remembering the fact. How then wouldest thou be clever, and how canst thou say, 'I see all'? Good man, thou takest darkness for light, and takest light for darkness." Whereupon the seers are asked by the man, "By what means and by what good work shall I acquire such wisdom, and with your favor acquire those good qualities or virtues?" And the seers say to that man, "If that be thy wish, go and live in the wilderness, or take thine abode in mountain caves to meditate on the law and cast off evil passions. So shalt thou become endowed with the virtues of an ascetic and acquire the transcendent faculties." The man catches their meaning and becomes an ascetic. Living in the wilderness, the mind intent upon one sole object, he shakes off worldly desires and acquires the five transcendent faculties. After that acquisition, he reflects thus, "Formerly I did not do the right thing, hence no good accrued to me. Now, however, I can go whither my mind prompts me. Formerly I was ignorant, of little understanding, in fact a blind man." Such, Kasyapa, is the parable I have invented to make thee understand my meaning. The moral to be drawn from it is as follows. The word blind-born, Kasyapa, is a designation for the creatures staying in the whirl of the world with its six states, the creatures who do not know the true law and are heaping up the thick darkness of evil passions. Those are blind from ignorance, and in consequence of it, they build up conceptions, in consequence of the latter name and form and so forth, up to the genesis of this whole huge mass of evils. So the creatures blind from ignorance remain in the world of life, but the Tathagata, who is out of the triple world, feels compassion, prompted by which, like a father for his dear and only son, he appears in the triple world and sees with his eye of wisdom that the creatures are revolving in the circle of the mundane whirl and are toiling without finding the right means to escape from the rotation. And on seeing this, he comes to the conclusion. Yon beings, according to the good works they have done in former states, have feeble aversions and strong attachments. Or feeble attachments and strong aversions. Some have little wisdom. Others are clever. Some have soundly developed views. Others have unsound views. To all of them, the Tathagata skillfully shows three vehicles. The seers in the parable, those possessing the five transcendent faculties and clear sight, are the bodhisattvas, who produce enlightened thought, and by the acquirement of acquiescence in the eternal law, awake us to supreme perfect enlightenment. The great physician in the parable is the Tathagata. To the blind born may be likened the creatures blind with infatuation. Attachment, aversion, and infatuation are likened to rheum, bile, and phlegm. The 62 false theories also must be looked upon as such, i.e. as doshas, humors, and corrupted humors of the body, faults, and corruptions. The four herbs are like vanity or voidness, causelessness or purposelessness, unfixedness, and reaching nirvana. Just as by using different drugs, different diseases are healed, so by developing the idea of vanity or voidness, purposelessness, unfixedness, which are the principles of emancipation, is ignorance suppressed. The suppression of ignorance is succeeded by the suppression of conceptions or fancies, and so forth, up to the suppression of the whole huge mass of evils, and thus one's mind will dwell no more on good nor on evil. To the man who recovers his eyesight is likened the votary of the vehicle of the disciples and of Pratyekabuddhas. He rends the ties of evil passion in the whirl of the world. Freed from those ties, he is released from the triple world with its six states of existence. Therefore, the votary of the vehicle of the disciples may think and speak thus. There are no more laws to be penetrated. I have reached nirvana. Then the Tathagata preaches to him, how can he who has not penetrated all laws have reached nirvana? The Lord rouses him to enlightenment, and the disciple, when the consciousness of enlightenment has been awakened in him, no longer stays in the mundane world, but at the same time has not yet reached nirvana. And he has arrived at true insight. He looks upon this triple world in every direction as void, resembling the produce of magic, similar to a dream, a mirage, an echo. He sees that all laws and phenomena are unborn and undestroyed, not bound and not loose, not dark and not bright. He who views the profound laws in such a light sees as if he were not seeing the whole triple world, full of beings of contrary and omnifarious fancies and dispositions. And on that occasion, in order to more amply explain the same subject, the Lord uttered the following stanzas. As the rays of the sun and moon descend alike on all men, good and bad, without deficiency in one case or surplus in the other, so the wisdom of the Tathagata shines like the sun and moon, leading all beings without partiality. As the potter making clay vessels produces from the same clay pots for sugar, milk, ghee, or water, some for impurities, others for curdled milk, the clay used by the artificer for the vessels being of but one sort, as a vessel is made to receive all its distinguishing qualities according to the quality of the substance laid into it, so the Tathagatas, on account of the diversity of taste, 50, mention a diversity of vehicles. Though the Buddha vehicle be the only indisputable one, he who ignores the rotation of mundane existence has no perception of blessed rest, but he who understands that all laws are void and without reality and without individual character penetrates the enlightenment of the perfectly enlightened lords in its very essence. One who occupies a middle position of wisdom is called a Pratyekagina, i.e. Pratyekabuddha. One lacking the insight of voidness is termed a disciple, but after understanding all laws, one is called a perfectly enlightened one. Such a one is assiduous in preaching the law to living beings by means of hundreds of devices. It is as if some blind-born man, because he sees no sun, moon, planets, and stars, in his blind ignorance should say, there are no visible things at all. But a great physician, taking compassion on the blind man, goes to the Himalaya, where, seeking a cross up and down, he fetches from the mountain four plants, the herb of all colors, flavors, and cases, and others. These he intends to apply. He applies them in this manner. One he gives to the blind man after chewing it, another after pounding, again another by introducing it with the point of a needle into the man's body. The man, having got his eyesight, sees the sun, moon, planets, and stars, and arrives at the conclusion that it was from sheer ignorance that he spoke thus as he had formerly done. In the same way do people of great ignorance, blind from their birth, move in the turmoil of the world because they do not know the wheel of causes and effects, the path of toils. 60. In the world so blinded by ignorance appears the highest of those who know all, the Tathagata, the great physician of compassionate nature. 61. As an able teacher, he shows the true law. He reveals supreme Buddha enlightenment to him who is most advanced. To those of middling wisdom, the leader preaches a middling enlightenment. Again, another enlightenment he recommends to him who is afraid of the mundane world. The disciple who, by his discrimination, has escaped from the triple world, thinks he has reached pure blessed nirvana. But it is only by knowing all laws and the universal laws that the immortal nirvana is reached. In that case, it is as if the great seers, moved by compassion, said to him, thou art mistaken, do not be proud of thy knowledge. When thou art in the interior of thy room, thou canst not perceive what is going on without. Fool as thou art. Thou who, when staying within, dost not perceive even now what people outside are doing or not doing, how wouldst thou be wise, fool as thou art? Thou art not able to hear a sound at a distance of but 5 yoganas, far less at a greater distance. Thou canst not discern who are malevolent or benevolent towards thee. Whence then comes that pride to thee? If thou hast to walk so far as a cost, thou canst not go without a beaten track, and what happened to thee when in thy mother's womb thou hast immediately forgotten. 70. In this world, he is called all-knowing who possesses the 5 transcendent faculties, but when thou who knowest nothing pretendest to be all-knowing, it is an effect of infatuation. 71. If thou art desirous of omniscience, direct thy attention to transcendent wisdom, then betake thyself to the wilderness and meditate on the pure law. By it thou shalt acquire the transcendent faculties. The man catches the meaning, goes to the wilderness, meditates with the greatest attention, and as he is endowed with good qualities, ere long acquires the 5 transcendent faculties. 73. Similarly, all disciples fancy, having reached nirvana, but the Gina instructs them by saying, this is a temporary repose, no final rest. It is an artifice of the Buddhists to enunciate this dogma. There is no real nirvana without all-knowingness. Try to reach this. The boundless knowledge of the 3 paths of time, the 6 utmost perfections, paramitas, voidness, the absence of purpose or object, the absence of finiteness, the idea of enlightenment and the other laws leading to nirvana, both such as are mixed with imperfection and such as are exempt from it, such as are tranquil and comparable to ethereal space. The 4 Brahma Viharas and the 4 Sangrahas, as well as the laws sanctioned by eminent sages for the education of creatures, 78. He who knows these things and that all phenomena have the nature of illusion and dreams, that they are pithless as the stem of the plantain and similar to an echo. And who knows that the triple world throughout is of that nature, not fast and not loose, he knows rest. 80. He who considers all laws to be alike, void, devoid of particularity and individuality, not derived from an intelligent cause, nay, who discerns that nothingness is law. 81. Such a one has great wisdom and sees the whole of the law entirely. There are no three vehicles by any means. There is but one vehicle in this world. 82. All laws or the laws of all are alike, equal for all and ever alike. Knowing this, one understands immortal, blessed nirvana.